Well, good morning, y'all, and happy Easter to you
and yours.
We are so excited to be with y'all on this lovely Easter Sunday, and we want to know where you are tuned in from today. So let us know down there in the chat. We want to welcome you on, whether it is your first time or your 100,000th time watching with us each and every Sunday. We want to get to know you. We want to connect with you. So let us know where you're watching from, who you're watching with, and who you are celebrating this Easter Sunday with.
Yeah, absolutely. And if it's your first time joining us on the stream, I literally cannot think of a better weekend.
Oh my goodness.
To be here for your very first time Easter weekend.
Immaculate here in the foyer. Like behind us, we've got some amazing family photos being taken. Uh-huh. Right out here on the patio, we got the Easter Bunny hanging out with some of our XR kids and families. We've got all sorts of awesome. So we got Easter Munch.
Easter Munch.
In the house.
I mean,
who wouldn't want to have chocolate covered, I think either your peanuts or raisins.
Uh-huh.
We got some cereal, some Cap'n Crunch, some pretzels,
marshmallows.
This is going to be amazing. We are going to go to town on this probably during the experience today.
Absolutely.
But we want to know what you're watching, you know, what you're having for your Easter breakfast, who you're hanging out with. Let us know right down there in the chat.
Yeah, and if it is your first time joining us this morning, make sure you click that link and fill out that information. We want this to be a two-way conversation. We want to get to know you, just like you're trying to figure out what exactly, you know, who we are and what we're doing around here for Easter Sunday. So definitely fill out that information in the chat so we can get in touch with you.
Yeah, and don't forget to share the stream today. Let's have a little fun in the chat, too.
Let's
a little conversation here. Speaking of Easter munchies, I want to know, what is our favorite Easter candy? So let us know down in their chat. What is, like, your go-to Easter candy? What do you have in your basket each and every year? Mike, I want to know, what is your go-to Easter candy?
So I'm a big fan of the caramel eggs, not the cream eggs.
Okay.
They're okay.
Oh, you fancy,
but I like the caramel eggs. I feel cheated if I have the cream eggs.
See,
but you said earlier you like the cream eggs.
Oh, I am, like, all in on the Cadbury cream eggs. I love those. I love the malted milk Robin eggs, the Whoppers Robin eggs things. They put in, like, the milk carton. I would, like, chug those as a kid and be done with the entire container within, like, a day.
So much.
Oh, I know. By, like, Easter Monday, we were done with all the candy. And, like, Starburst jelly beans. I like any jelly bean that isn't the, like, OG jelly beans.
Right,
because
if
you accidentally get that black licorice jelly bean,
no.
Like, Easter is automatically ruined
for me.
Exactly. But let me know in the chat, what is your go-to Easter candy as we just dive into some community this morning as an online family? And, hey, speaking of fun and Easter and excitement, just down the hall over here, our World Changers, our XR kids, are having an epic Easter celebration together as a church family. They're doing egg hunts, of course. They're hanging out with the Easter Bunny. They're learning the Easter message today. Doing a special worship experience, and they're doing an awesome Easter craft as well. They're putting together a trophy to celebrate that he is up and out of the grave and he has won, and it is just an awesome experience over there. But I got a chance to slide over there and get an inside scoop of everything going on in XR Kids this weekend. Check out this video, y'all. And they are having so much fun.
It looks like a
blast.
Just
down the hall right now, celebrating the Easter season. Hey, maybe you were watching that video and you're like, man, I want to get involved in XR Kids. I want to be one of the serve team leaders over there. Or just, I want to get involved in serving in some way, shape, or form right here at Crossroads Church. Well, the perfect opportunity for that is to attend Growth Track. That is our two-week session to learn everything about all things XR, our mission, our vision, our values as a church, and learn a little bit more about you as well.
Yeah.
Like your spiritual gifts, your your personality traits and how that connects with serving here in the church and in the Capital C Church and all over the community as well. So if you're interested in diving on to Growth Track for this month, the first one will be coming up next Sunday, and you can get signed up right now over at xrchurch.com, or we'll drop a link right there in the chat for you.
Yeah, check that out. Another way to get plugged in around here are what we call connect groups.
Yes.
Connect groups are happening right now. It's never too late to join a connect group. Like, don't worry about it. Just sign up, show up.
Yeah.
You know, sign up for multiple. And what I love about connect groups, it's, you know, it's outside of the four walls of the church.
Yeah.
I mean, we have connect groups meeting up in Hagerstown, Winchester, Charlestown, all over the place,
mm-hmm.
all with the purpose of getting together in those smaller groups and, you know, networking and talking about God and having some fun in the process
right.
as well. I mean, there's coffee meetups, there's bowling, there's I've seen all sorts of things happening this connect season. So check out that information in the chat. It's never too late to join a connect group here at XR.
Yeah. Yeah, and there are so many ways to get into community here at Crossroads Church, and there are even some great opportunities for our preteens and teens here in the house, our middle and high schoolers with
yep.
XR Youth. So many cool activities going on each and every Wednesday here at Crossroads where everybody can get together,
yep.
do games and activities, learn more about Jesus, and get to hang out with their middle and high school classmates and
yep.
friends. It's so much fun. They do all sorts of like special things at least like once or twice out of the month. Like last week they did like an awkward Easter family photos
yeah.
type of event.
I saw
and,
that, yeah.
And it's just really cool to see kind of the themes that they have. So they'll be back again. This week they'll be all together for First Wednesday, but the following week is when they'll be back again officially for XR Youth, coming out of that nice little spring hiatus that they have going on. But if you want to learn more about XR Youth, we're going to drop a link down there in the chat so that maybe if you are a middle or high schooler and you want to get involved, or if your kids are in middle or high school, they can get involved as well.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And I know we're deep into Easter weekend, so it's kind of hard to think about, you know, anything after this weekend, but
sure.
next weekend's a very special weekend around
oh, yeah.
this house as well. It is baptism weekend. There is information dropping in the chat. You can click that link. You can, you know, find out what it means to go public with
yeah.
your faith. But
oh,
I think
yeah.
really the best way to share it is through a personal testimony. Check out this video.
Coming to XR, I've been convicted since coming here, even while we were watching online last year, because I gave everything to God except for my finances. Then came January with the 21 days of prayer and fasting. And God just came down on me, and I was grumpy the 21 days because I knew what I needed to do. And I was just kicking against it. I was like, no, I can't, because I know exactly if we tithe, we will truly have to trust on you, God. Well, I took a step in faith, and I tithed on the full 10%, and our bank account was showing red. And so I said, God, you have to literally put money in our bank account. And since tithing, God has, through bonuses, through gifts, through unexpected incentives, God has put money into my bank account. And I was just, there's a verse in Malachi that says, test God in this, and I don't know why I never tested him before. I guess because I just feel like I had to have control of it, but God has proven himself to be faithful. So me going into the water is just fully committing, God, this is, I'm giving everything to you. This is just proclaiming God's goodness and his faithfulness, that he is truly God the provider.
Matt's story is incredible, and it's just
yeah.
one of many testimonies around this house. So if you are interested in water baptism or learning more, click that link in the chat. And everything that we're talking about today reminds me of the opportunities that exist because of your generosity.
Right.
So if you'd like to give today, there's information dropping in the chat, or you can give anytime by visiting xrchurch.com/give. You know, giving that gift of the Easter season, it, you know, in a way, it's the perfect weekend to
yeah.
jump in. Maybe if you
oh,
haven't
yeah.
given in a while, or and it's not about the amount, it's about the heart behind it. So
mm-hmm.
whatever you have to give this morning, that information
yeah.
is available in the chat.
Absolutely. And church, the Easter excitement does not end today.
Right.
Because we have got
right.
an April 1st Wednesday coming up in just three
yeah,
days
yeah.
from now. A great opportunity to get together with community, communion, a nice intimate time of worship together as a church
it.
Family right here in the house.
Yeah.
We want you to come on out. It's Wednesday, 7 p.m. Come on out early. Hang out here in the
yeah,
foyer
right
with
here.
All of us as we keep those Easter vibes going.
Absolutely.
Well, speaking of Easter vibes and excitement,
here we
we're
go.
Ready to dive into our worship experience. He is up and out of the grave. Amen. We are so excited to celebrate Easter Sunday with each and every one of you. It's now time for Easter at Crossroads.
The earth was formless, empty, a void. The spark of creation. Out of nothing, God created light. The oceans, mountains, the galaxy. And then, you. He filled the world with everything we needed to thrive. But humanity disobeyed God and were cast out of Eden. Nations rose and fell as God built his kingdom on earth. Humanity needed a savior. God, in his love, sent Jesus down to walk among us, to teach us a better way, to save us from our sin. He took up a cross and died in our place.
I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my.
Our hope was laid to rest in a borrowed tomb. But the rocks couldn't hold our Savior. History was rewritten when the Son of God breathed once more. A promise fulfilled. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, he will stand on the earth. In every mountain and valley, in every smile and shed tear, the Creator of the universe, the Savior of the world, stands with you. Jesus' victory over death means that we are able to rise with him. Every battle, every circumstance, you don't need to rely on your own strength. Fix your eyes on him. See the eyes of your Father, your friend, your constant companion, your healer. The eyes of a God who took your place so you can live.
Took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. from the darkness into glorious light.
Come on, he's worthy. He is worthy. He's our risen King. Come on, give him praise. What a God we serve, right? We praise you, Lord.
See the tomb where he lay. See the stone roll away. He is risen. He is risen. He's alive. See his hands. See his feet. Touch his scars and believe. He is risen. He is risen. He's alive. No. He's alive.
Come on, church.
He lives. All honor and power are his. And all glory forever. Amen. Jesus lives.
Yeah.
Hear the shackles breaking free. Hear the song of the redeemed. He is moving, he is moving, he's alive. Oh, so take this freedom, take this love. Can you feel it rising up? He is here, he is here, he's alive.
To Easter at Crossroads Church. We are so excited that you're here with us today. My name is Jessica, and my husband and I have the privilege of serving as pastors here at Crossroads. And today what we get to do is we get to join with millions of people around the world who are celebrating the fact that Jesus left heaven, he came to earth, he died for our sins, he rose again. And because love won, the same power that raised Jesus from the grave wants to make you alive again this morning as well. So that's what we're celebrating all day long on this beautiful Easter Sunday, and we're so glad you're a part of it. If it's your very first time, we just want to say a big welcome. We're glad you're here. We hope that you had a chance to stop by the Connect Center. We have a gift we'd love to give you and just get to know you a little bit more. Because around here, we're about four things. We want to be people who know God. We want to find personal freedom. We want to discover our unique purpose, and then we want to go out and make a difference. Because we believe that God has a plan and a purpose for your life. We also believe that God has a plan and a purpose for your kids' lives as well. That's why they are having a blast back in XR Kids. They have a special Easter service for each age group. They're having a ball. There's egg hunts happening. So if you have kids in here this morning and they heard egg hunts and they want to join in, it's not too late. You can take them on back. We're the more the merrier people around here. Well, in just a moment, we're going to go back into a worship song, and we're just going to continue to declare that God is good. He is risen. He is up out of the grave. Amen? Amen. Well, before we do that, would you just posture your heart with me in prayer this morning as we invite God into this space? Lord, we love you. We thank you, God, for who you are, for what you did, that all those years ago that you saw us in this moment today. Lord, we accept your love. Lord, we are grateful for your love. We're grateful for the gift of church and each other that we can come in and celebrate your love for us, Lord. So we know that you have a word you want to speak for us today, uniquely and personally. So we open up our heart to hear from you. We glorify your name. We magnify your name. And it is in that name, in the name of Jesus, that the church said amen. Amen.
Let's continue in this time of worship this morning. Lord Jesus, we love you. God, we thank you for who you are. And this morning we sing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We bless your name, Jesus. A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all have gone before us, and all who will believe, we sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And sing, your name is the highest. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high. If you've been redeemed, sing a song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, if you bear his name, sing a song forever to the Lamb. Oh, sing a song forever and amen. Cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If your people sing, holy.
the highest, your name is the greatest, your name, oh, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
Come on, church, let's sing together.
Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above all. Oh, thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name, oh, stands above all.
Jesus, and he reigns above all. We thank you, Lord, that you reign above it all. We bless your name today, God. Let's sing this together, church.
No enemy can hold you down, cause there's nobody in the grave now. One head gets to wear that crown, cause there's nobody in the grave now. No enemy can hold you down, cause there's nobody in the grave now. One hand gets to wear that crown, cause there's nobody in the grave now. No enemy can hold you down, cause there's nobody in the grave now. One hand gets to wear that crown, cause there's nobody.
Nobody in the grave.
Easter, baby.
Nobody in the grave. Man, don't you just love this season where we celebrate the end of sin, the end of the power that sin held on us? Because Jesus walked out of the tomb triumphantly declaring, I was who I claimed to be, the unique, matchless Son of the living God. You want proof of that? Peer into the tomb. Ain't nobody in the grave now. Nobody, 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 nobody. It's Easter. Every time the devil tries a sneak attack on you and remind you of your past, remind him there's nobody in the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, sickness, where is your hold? Or addiction, where is your power? There's nobody in the grave. Get it? Nobody. Celebrating. Hey, we've been through a lot. We've been through a lot of challenges, hurts, hang-ups, drama, and trauma. And the devil thought he had the last laugh when the Roman soldiers put Jesus on the cross. But here we are, telling the tale, talking the talk, celebrating. There ain't nobody in the grave. And the Bible says the same power that raised Jesus from the grave lives inside of us. And we can be made new again too, just like him. Come on, isn't that awesome? I love it, really do. Well, welcome to Crossroads Easter 24. We're so excited to have you here, your family, your friends, everybody joining us online right now, and everybody over in the theater room. Hey everybody, can we just say welcome to everybody on our campuses, kids, foyer, auditorium, theater, online. So glad you're here. I believe that God's got a word for you today, and I believe that he wants to speak to you, and he will. And so just know this, if this is your first time, no matter where you've been and the hurt that you have caused and the hurts that you have received, let me tell you this, you're far better than the person you're sitting by. Just know that. Just know that. You don't even want to know their story. It's nasty. It's nasty. And yet we all find commonality at the cross. All of that to say this, you belong here. You belong here. And we're going to go on a journey together, discovering the Easter story from a different perspective than probably you've looked at or thought of before. And so put your hand over your heart. Let me pray for you, everybody online as well. Lord Jesus, thank you that the tomb is empty. Thank you for coming back to life and beginning a new relationship with us. We ask now that you would push back any distractions around us and in us and in our mind, and give us ears to hear and a mind to receive all that you have for us today. May the same power that raised Jesus from the grave all those years ago be our story today. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, come on, amen. Amen. While you're taking your seat, tell the person on your left, you look better than I remember. Just go ahead and let them know. Come on. You look way better than I remember. So good. If you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 27. Matthew 27. If you're new to our house, we just explore what the Bible has to say. We believe that the Bible is not only a book of God, but it's the book that God wrote for us to know him and for us to be introduced to an us that we haven't met just yet. All that to say that God has a you that you haven't met yet, that he wants to journey you from where you are to where he wants you to be. And so we want to look at what the Bible says about God and what God has to say about us and our life. And so around here, we would call it a sermon series, but maybe it'd help you understand what I'm talking about. It's a collection of talks in which we have been in this series in which we are looking at the Easter story from obscure characters that weren't in the tomb. No, that was Jesus. They didn't go to the cross, that was Jesus. But they are still very much a part of the Easter story. And so by understanding these individuals, we're able to understand their story, and we find ourselves in their story, and their story becomes our story. And then together, our story is an invitation into the Easter story. And so where we've been so far as a house is, first, in week one, we looked at Pontius Pilate. He was the individual, he was the governor of Judea, working for the Caesar of Rome. He's the one who put Jesus on trial and ultimately convicted or sentenced him to crucifixion. His big problem was that he was a people pleaser. And we talked about how there comes a point in time in your life where you've got to start making decisions for yourself. There comes a point in time where you're going to have to decide. Come on, everybody say decisions, decisions, decisions. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Where you are going to have to decide whether you want to please God or please people. And he was confined. He was in his own prison cell of people pleasing. And then we looked at a familiar individual that we're not too proud of, Judas. And we talked about the sting of betrayal and what we can learn from the sting of painful relationships and events. What we don't want to do is just put a label on a person, an event, or a situation. They're bad. That situation was bad. No, no, no. Because then we become bitter, not better. And so we talked about how we can leverage betrayal in a bad situation to develop us on the inside. And then last week, we looked at this obscure character who actually carried the cross of Jesus from a dusty cobblestone road headed out of Jerusalem to Golgotha, known as Skull's Hill, the place where Jesus would die. And we looked at what do we do when life forces us to carry involuntary burdens and crosses. You are minding your own business, you are doing your own thing, and then somewhere, something, an event, a sickness, a situation, a setback came out of nowhere, forcing us to shoulder a burden. We looked at it. And so if you are new to us or if you missed those installments, I pray that you'd go back and may it add value to you in this season of your life. Today we want to look at our last figure around the Easter story as his story becomes our story and our story is his story and it invites us into the story of Easter. Everybody say, decisions, 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 decisions. Do you remember what it was like when we were little kids and we had to make a big, weighty decision? Now, we didn't know about risk assessment tools and charts and data, and we didn't know how to phone a friend, and we didn't know always how to seek wise counsel, and we didn't know about the SWOT analysis or anything. No, no, no. We just turned to the time-tested, universal tool to make great, wise, practical decisions, known as eeny, meeny, miny, mo. You know what I'm talking about? Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Catch a tiger by its toe. And if he hollers, make him pay. My mommy told me to pick the very best one, and you are not it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And if we landed on something that we really didn't want, we would try again, starting from a different point of reference, right? Bubblegum in a dish. How many pieces? I love it. And you know, things got stressful in our fifth grade life when we had to decide between two choices, us and our friend, by harnessing the power of paper, rock, scissors, shoot. You know what I'm talking about? Paper, rock, scissors, shoot. How many of you made up one? Paper, rock, scissors, shoot, bomb. Oh, I win. Do you remember when we were in elementary school and it used to make us so mad because we would work so hard over a project, a art project, a story, a presentation of some sort, but then the teacher picked the winner by who won by sheer volume and noise in the crowd? Whoever makes the most noise wins. Is it this guy? Is it this girl? How many of you got ticked off by that? Good. You know what I'm talking about? Because it's no longer about the project. It's a popularity contest at that point. It's ridiculous. It's crazy. It's no way to make a decision. And when we come to today's Easter passage, we're introduced to a man of significance, prominence, power, wealth, influence, position in Rome. And he's going to make a life or death situation, but he doesn't know which decision to make because whatever decision he makes, he's going to make the other group mad. And this is not a time for paper, rock, scissors, shoot. But in his mind, it is a time to let the crowd decide for him. His career and his life hangs in the balance, and he's going to delegate his decision to culture, to social media, to society, to the crowd, to the mob. By the way, be careful of the voices you allow to direct and influence your life. Just because they're loud and they're familiar and they're consistent doesn't make them right. That's why the Bible says choose for yourself who you will serve. Because the loudest voice in the room may not always be the right voice. For the past few years, tension hangs in the air in Rome between the Roman establishment, the Caesar of Rome, and the Jewish people. And so in order to curry favor with the Jews, once a year, the Roman government issued what we would call, in our vernacular, a presidential pardon, allowing for a convicted Jewish criminal or inmate to be set free. The Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, is a man desperately navigating the delicacy between power, influence, and popularity, his career, his life. About 3 or 4 years prior to this moment we're about to unpack, some of the religious Jewish leaders subverted their governor and they went straight to the emperor of Rome, demanding that he put a check and balance on Pontius Pilate. He was a violent man. He was an aggressive man. He was a vile man. He was a racist of a man. And so he was overly oppressing the Jewish people. And so these religious leaders, they got together. They went to Caesar and said, if you don't get your boy in check, we're going to start a revolt and we're going to wreak havoc in your jurisdiction. Caesar then put Pilate on notice that if you can't keep peace in your jurisdiction, I'm going to recall you back to Rome, and it's either going to be your career or your life. And so Pilate's got to get this moment right. The problem he has is that the same religious leaders who went around him to go to Caesar are now the same group of people that stand outside his door demanding they murder this individual. This individual has won the hearts of the people. Unfortunately, he's not won the hearts of the religious elite. Pilate doesn't know what to do. Do I follow through on what they want me to do, risking that there would be an uprising amongst some Jews? Do I do what I know is right, my own conviction, or do I do what the mob wants me to do? He goes back into his president or his governor suite, if you will. In my biblical imagination, I see him taking a long drag on a filter tip. Maybe he takes a shot of, I don't know, because we're in West Virginia, moonshine, something like that. You know, grandpa's old cough syrup, he's trying to wake up. It's early in the morning. And he's thinking about it. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And then he has a light bulb moment. Here's what I'll do. I'll leverage the presidential pardon, and I'll make them decide what I should do. That way, they are to blame, and I can wash my hands and be found innocent of the decision. So he has a good idea. This is a no-brainer. He's going to juxtapose this man they want dead, Jesus, against the worst criminal they currently have in Roman lockup. And so he addresses the crowd something like this. Men of Judah, today, traditionally, is the day in which I grant you a choice for a presidential pardon. You tell me who you want set free. So I offer you up Jesus, the man with the reputation of healing the sick, clothing the naked, feeding the poor. His teachings are pure, they're kind. He speaks of forgiveness and peace and love. He tells us how to know God, how to find personal freedom. He teaches us how to make our home in heaven. So I offer you this man, King of the Jews, or I give you the most vile and violent inmate we have in Roman lockup. He's a murderer, he's a liar, he's a manipulator, and he's a rebel. He has caused multiple insurrections in and around Rome. Matter of fact, he is responsible for many deaths of your own people. I offer you Barabbas. Any normal person would have stepped back in shock. Not Barabbas, not the monster of Rome. There's blood on his hands. He's a criminal. He's a vile man, not Barabbas. Pilate says, I have made my case. Jesus or Barabbas. Matter of fact, the way Pilate presents this option to the men of Judea is interesting. And there's a detail here that I don't want you to miss. And matter of fact, you wouldn't believe it unless I read it straight from Scripture. So watch this, Matthew 27, 17. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" You see it? Both their names are Jesus. In the first century, especially among Jews, the name Jesus was a common name because it's derived from the Hebrew name Yeshua, which is where we get our English word Joshua. Joshua was a hero amongst the Jews because he is the one who took over after Moses died and led the Israelites into the promised land. Not only that, but the name Yeshua or Joshua literally means rescuer, savior, and deliverer. So we have rescuer, savior, deliverer, Barabbas, and rescue, savior, deliverer, Jesus, who is called the Christ. What is even more interesting is his last name. The name Barabbas is derived from two Aramaic words, bar, meaning son, and abbas, or abba, meaning papa, father. His name literally means son of papa, son of daddy, son of the father. Jesus called himself to be son of the father. So we have savior, son of the father, savior, son of the father. They both have the same message. They are both leaders in their own right, and they are both leading an insurrection against the normalcy of today. They are both building a kingdom and asking for people to follow them into a new reality. It's just one is speaking of Rome. The other one is speaking of heaven. One is speaking of temporary power. The other one is speaking of eternal glory. One is speaking of swords. The other one is speaking of peace. Eye for an eye. Turn the other cheek. Cling, get, clamor, push over other people. Power holds might and glory. Blessed are the humble and the merciful, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Both savior, deliverer, rescuer. One is of Rome, one is of eternal matters. The story goes on. Matthew 27, verse 21. Which of the two Jesuses, which two sons of the Father do you want me to release to you? Asked the governor. They answered, Barabbas. Then Pilate asked, then what shall I do then with Jesus who is called the Messiah? See, Pilate doesn't realize he just asked the most important question in the Bible and throughout all of time and space and eternity. What do I do with Jesus? I got to do something with him. Pilate has options. Do I listen to myself? Do I listen to my wife? Do I listen to my advisors? Do I listen to the crowd? Do I listen to Caesar of Rome? All he knows is that a decision must be made and neutrality is not an option. Choose right now, today, who I will release. And by the way, we all have to come to that place where we ask what Pilate asked. What do I do with Jesus? I got to do something with him. He's on trial in my mind. I'm putting him on trial. Do I believe he is, in fact, who he claimed to be, the Son of God? Or was he a crazy man talking out of his mind? He's a lunatic. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Or was he a liar? We have to ask what Pilate asked. What shall I do with Jesus? What shall I do with Jesus who is the Messiah? Pilate asked. And the crowd answered, crucify him. Now, this is an interesting detail. From a geological perspective, we know that Barabbas was incarcerated at the fortress of Antonia, which is only about 1,000 feet from where Pilate is having this conversation with the mob. Which means then that Barabbas, he's close enough to hear the shout of the crowd, but he's far enough removed that he cannot hear the thin, singular voice of Pilate. In other words, he can hear the shout of the crowd, but he doesn't hear the question that Pilate's asking. So from his perspective, he hears his name being chanted, Barabbas, Barabbas, Barabbas.
Pilate says, what do I do with Jesus? He hears, crucify, crucify. In his cell, he hears his name and the sentence of death by crucifixion. Barabbas, crucify. Barabbas, crucify. Have you ever known it was you? Like you sitting alone in your prison cell, you're alone in your own thoughts, and you hear your name and your sentence? Where do you think that mob of the mind comes from? The Bible says it is the greatest prosecutor in human existence, that is Satan himself. His number one job is to follow you around and condemn you of your sin. So the devil calls you by your name, followed by your shame. You by name, shame on you. Guilty are you. Barabbas, crucify. Barabbas, crucify. You ever felt shame and condemnation like that? That's not the voice of your father. That is the son of the father. What shall I do with Jesus? They shouted, crucify. Barabbas is alone in a cell. He hears his name and he hears the sentence of death. But it's Jesus who stands before Pilate. And it's Jesus who stands before the mob. He looks at them in the eyes and he can feel their hatred and their animosity. He can feel the energy of brutality in the room, and it's Jesus who sees them glare at him and have their finger shoved at his face. Crucify him, kill him. Barabbas thinks he's moments away from his death, but it's Jesus who knows. He won't be carrying a cross today. It'll be me. I'm just wondering if in this moment, the mind of Christ wasn't nudged back to the night before in the Garden of Gethsemane when he knelt down to pray before he was ultimately betrayed by Judas, arrested and carried off into trial. Mark 14 tells us that Jesus knelt to pray and he said this, Abba, see it? Abba, Father, son of the Father here, talking to my Father. Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Father, you can do anything. Might is in your name. Love is in your name. Power is in your name. Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. So take this cup of suffering and justice and wrath from me. And yet, not my will, but yours be done. The Gospel of Luke tells us that when Jesus was finished praying, the angels came and ministered to him. I've always wondered what the angels said to him. How do you encourage somebody who knows their fate? I'm just wondering if one of those big old angels knelt down beside him and said, Son of the Father, your Father heard your prayer. He heard you. And you are right, everything is possible for your Father. He can remove the suffering of divine justice and wrath from you. But the wages of sin is death, and somebody's got to be held accountable for the sins of humanity. So either you drink the cup or they will. And Jesus knows in this moment that God is going to have to treat innocent Jesus like guilty Barabbas so that he can treat guilty Barabbas like innocent Jesus. We would call this the greatest prisoner exchange of all time. The innocent will be held guilty for crimes he didn't commit so that the one who's guilty can go free. The Bible says that Jesus rose from bended knees and he says, let it be me. I'll drink the cup. This is what 2 Corinthians is talking about when it says that God made Jesus, who never sinned, be sin on our behalf so that those of us who have sinned might become children of God. In other words, children of the Father. God wants to take that part of us that resembles and mirrors Barabbas and turn it into Bar Abba, son of the Father. Pilate, wanting to satisfy the crowd over his own convictions, gave the crowd what they wanted. And Matthew 27 ends this story with, then he released Barabbas to them, but he handed Jesus over to be crucified. The last thing that Barabbas heard up until this moment, of course, is he's sitting in a cell. And we got to ask ourselves, what is he thinking? What is he feeling? Does he feel regret and remorse? Does he feel entitled? Is he running through the reasons why he did what he did? Is he trying to prove himself, defend himself, justify himself? Has he accepted his fate? Is he fearing death itself? We don't know. All we know is that he is a convicted criminal sentenced to death by crucifixion, and he just heard the mob shout, "Barabbas, crucify!" And now here comes the footsteps of a Roman soldier. He can hear the keys wrestling in the man's hand, and the iron gate opens. Barabbas looks up to meet the gaze of a Roman soldier, and he's expecting this arrogant, authoritative voice, "Let's go! Time for you to pay for your sins." But instead, he hears a humble, confused tone, "You're free to go. They took Jesus instead." Now, we don't know what happened next, but we do know that Barabbas was set free, and he had one of two choices. Either he could run for the hills and return to his old way of life, doing old Barabbas things, maybe feeling entitled, "Yeah, I got people, I got influence." Or maybe, just maybe, there was just enough humility in the man, just enough curiosity in the man, to go to Golgotha's hill and investigate the one who took his place. Don't you wish you could go back in time? Barabbas, you and I both know you've done some terrible things, and you deserve to be on that cross. But God so much loved the world, he gave us the Son of the Father, named Rescuer and Deliverer and Savior, that if anyone should believe in his reality, though they were guilty as charged, yet shall they live and walk in freedom. Barabbas, this is about the Son of the Father taking the place of the Son of the Father. This is about the innocent becoming guilty so that the guilty could find innocence. This is about those of us with a past, those with us mounted in a cloak of shame and guilt and pain and heartache and confusion, those of us who have participated in divine insurrection like Barabbas, rediscovering our identity, Son of Abba. Eventually, Barabbas went one of two ways, reminding us that we have a decision that we need to make. Decisions, decisions, decisions. We must answer Pilate's question, "What do I do with Jesus?" And so Easter reminds us of two things. Number one, there is an end to sin when we put our faith in the one who put an end to sin. And there is a possibility of new life for anyone who would believe. There's an end to sin, and there's new life. There's new resurrection for anyone who chooses to simply believe. I don't know about you, but sometimes I wish it was harder than just belief, because then I know that it's working. Or maybe just working for something fills the self-righteous part of me that makes me feel like I deserve it. After all, look at what I've done. My good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, and I've worked for it, and I've earned it. And Jesus would say, "No, this ain't no partnership. You deserve to die. You Barabbas." But God, so rich in mercy, took the place of the guilty so that you don't have to strive for it, you don't have to earn it, you don't have to pay for it, you don't have to balance the scales of your bad actions versus your good actions. No, the Bible simply says, "Come to the foot of the cross, lay your sin down, and I, Jesus, the Son of the Father, will," it's a promise, "give," because it's a free gift, "you," it's personal to you, Barabbas. We are Barabbas. And so Easter reminds us then that Easter is not about survival remorse where we feel bad about sending Jesus to the cross in our stead. It's about triumphantly walking in the resurrection that he crawled off the cross. He went in the tomb. He walked out of the grave, and he started a conversation with us. "I will give you life, freedom, hope, mercy, forgiveness, redemption, resurrection, and purpose, not just today, but all the days of your life." Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And so watch this. Easter reminds us the access to this level of forgiveness and this level of a relationship with the Heavenly Father is simply accessible through faith and surrender. Where we say, God, I give you my sin and I submit to your lordship. You are God, I am not. All that I know how in this moment, I choose to follow you. Would you wash me of my sins and would you help me live for you? Help me look like you a little bit more tomorrow than I do today, a little more the next day than I did tomorrow. And God begins an ongoing, lifelong conversation called a relationship with us, in which he changes the label from the insurrectionist Barabbas to Bar Abba, son of the Father. Stand up with me across this place. I want to invite you to do something rather bold. Sometimes the best decisions are on the other side of courageous decisions. Sometimes your best yes is on the other side of physical movement. There's something about moving physically that mirrors a spiritual reality. My heart's moving. My soul's moving. I mean this. I want to make this my new reality. I want to make this my new beginning. This isn't show and tell weekend. It's not a performance. It's not even an event. No. This is just another day in which we pursue the resurrected Christ himself, who wants to have a relationship with us. Just want to point out that Jesus set Barabbas free, but Barabbas had to take his first step out of the cell. Jesus was brought back to life, but sooner or later, he had to take his first step out of the tomb. And for you to begin a life with Christ, you need to take your first step too. So I'm going to ask you to do what Pilate could not do, and that is ignore the voices of the crowd, their perspective, their thoughts. Who cares what the crowd thinks? When we're talking about something of eternal importance and eternal matters, who cares? When I married my wife, I didn't do it in a back room somewhere. Hey, don't tell nobody. No. I wanted everybody to know. I have found the one my soul loves, and I think she loved me too. And so we invited everybody. We invited the crowd. We wanted the crowd to be there to witness the exchanging of vows. I'm giving you my heart. And then she gave me hers. When we come to Christ, that's sort of what it's like. It's a marriage, really. I'm committing my life to you, Jesus, son of the Father. Make me more like you. I submit my life to you. And sooner or later, you've got to answer the question Pilate is begging us to answer. What do you do with Jesus? And I'm just asking you to care less about what people think and to care more about what God thinks and to take your first step into a new reality of walking with Jesus. So the prayer partners are going to come forward. I'm going to pray. And then when I'm done, I'm going to count to three. And if this is you, I want you to get out from your seat and I want you to come forward. And I want, I'm asking you to give us 30 seconds to pray for you, get to know your name, give you a free Bible, and give you a little card to fill out. The only purpose of that card is so that we can send you additional free resources. Because this is not the end point, it's the starting point. Oh, I don't know, a little inconvenient, gotta make my way through the crowd. Yeah. To get Jesus? Well worth it. Look at what he did for us. And I'll say this, sometimes the world, the crowd, the mob, they're actually waiting on a Joshua. Somebody to go first. A leader to step out and say, though none go with me, still I will follow. I have found the one my soul longs for. I have found the one my soul needs. I have found the one that my spirit is thirsty for. So if I'm the only one, I'm the only one. But if 100 follow me, then let it be known that there was a Joshua in this moment in time that rose up on the inside of me and said, I want my Savior. I want my Deliverer. I want my Rescuer. I have found him. His name is Jesus, the Christ, Son of the Father. Is that you? Are you ready to move? Are you ready to make this Easter different than every other month of your life? I believe that God's going to leverage this season to make it the best season of your life because it's going to be the most focused decision of your life. Are you ready? God, I thank you for new beginnings.
I thank you for a triumphal exit from the tomb. I thank you that the same power now that raised Jesus from the grave is the same power that can bring the dead part of us back to life and begin a relationship with you. One, help us to care more about our eternal state and the thoughts of our Heavenly Father than the crowd around us. We are ready to meet with you. One, two, three, let's begin to move. Come on. Let's begin to move. There it is. Congratulations, sir. God bless you. Come on. Anybody else? In the theater room, there's people up front. Come on, online, let us know in the chat. Jesus is ready to meet with his people. Pilate thought he had it. The devil thought he can hold it. The grave thought he could incarcerate him. Oh, death, where is your sting? Congratulations, sir. Sir. Come on, I want to pray for you, but if your heart is still stirred and your heart still wants to move, you just respond accordingly. Why don't you put your hands in the air? Lord Jesus, we thank you for the Easter story. Lord, we thank you that we find ourselves in the story. In this case, we're not the hero. We are the insurrectionist, and that is the power of the story. For you came at your best when we were at our worst, and you saved us, you delivered us, you rescued us. True to your name, Yeshua, you are Son of the Father. Thank you for the invitation and the privilege, as humble as it is, to walk in the new life with you. All that we know how in this moment, we give our life to you. Help us to follow you. Help us to continue this ongoing conversation and relationship with you. We invite you to become Lord of our life. In Jesus' name. Now one more time, put your hands together. Come on, let's celebrate. What was once lost is now found. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a Barabbas like me. Come on. I once was lost, now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Happy Easter, everybody. God bless you. We're going to see you right here for First Wednesday.
Well, what a powerful Easter message.
Amazing.
This weekend. And, you know, if you just took that call, if you just accepted, you put your hand up in the chat, or maybe, you know, in person, you put your hand up there from your couch or wherever you're watching us from today, there's some information dropping in the chat just for you. You know, Pastor sort of did an altar call right there in person, but we have a virtual altar call, if you will, right there in the chat. So check that out.
Absolutely. And congratulations and welcome to the family. We want to also say, too, that we are praying with you and praising God with you in this season and in any season. We want to know if you have any prayer requests or praise reports that you'd love to submit to us or share with us. We've got a link right there in the chat for that as well.
Yeah, and don't forget, this Wednesday, we're back for First Wednesday right here, Crossroads Martinsburg, 7 p.m. You definitely want to check that out online as well.
Yeah, and it's an amazing season, too, because we've got Baptism Weekend coming up next weekend as well. Maybe you accepted Christ into your life this weekend, and you're feeling that call to take that extra next step next weekend and make that outward declaration of your inward commitment to Christ. Get involved with Baptism. We got the signups right there in the chat as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, hey, church fam, we love you. Have a wonderful Easter weekend. We'll see you back here on Wednesday, 7 p.m. for First Wednesday. Take care.
See you guys.